Please hang up and try again.
This is America's Healthcare Challenge with Sean McGuire. Your host, Sean McGuire.
Thank you so much for your time and for listening and doing the best to inform yourself. We're going to be looking today at what are the differences between Medicare Advantage plans and Medicare Supplement plans as part of our ongoing series to help you make the difficult benefit decisions that are affecting you. And we've got a terrific program lined up for you. We're going to be joined right now by Stuart Slonin, president of SIG Consulting, contributor extraordinaire here on America's Healthcare Challenge, going to help us with this kind of a difficult subject for a lot of people. And there are some things that are changing a lot as of late. And we're going to begin, Stuart, with helping folks understand Medicare in general, starting with Parts A and B. Do you want to take it away?
Yeah, let's dive in there. Excuse me. Medicare Part A is hospital insurance and covers costs associated with confinement in a hospital or a skilled nursing facility. And what that is when you're hospitalized for 1 to 60 days, Medicare covers most confinement costs after the required deductible, which you pay $1,288 is the deductible for this year. From 61 to 90 days, it's $322 a day copayment for as much as $9,660 for that 61 to 90-day period. And then 91 through the 150th day is $644 a day with a copayment which adds up to almost $38,000 and change. And that includes a small skilled nursing confinement benefit. After 20 days, it's $161 a day, and the copayment could be as much as $12,880. So that's Medicare Part A. When we get to Medicare Part B, Medicare Part B is medical insurance and covers physician services, outpatient costs, tests, and supplies. Annual deductible there is $166 a year. Medical expenses include physician services for inpatient, outpatient, medical, surgical, physical, speech therapy, and diagnostic testing, clinical, lab services, home health care, part-time or intermittent skilled care, outpatient hospital treatment, blood pays 80% of approved amount after the first three pints of blood, and excess doctor charges above Medicare-approved amounts.
Wow, so there's a lot to digest. A lot of people don't really realize that they could be on the hook for so much money, do they? When they first begin going into Medicare.
No, it's true. It's true. And for a lot of folks who cross over that line from under age 65, where they would cover it individually, either in one of the Obamacare plans, or they cross over, from an employer-sponsored plan or individual plans. Now suddenly the Medicare rules apply once you're age 65.
Mm-hmm. And that can also vary upon someone's income, correct?
That's true.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we won't get into that too much because you'd have to check out our other program a couple of times ago where we really looked at that with the Part D prescription drug availability thing and something that's really important. But we're sticking to Parts A and B right now. So Part
A. Yeah,
we're
going to cover that in another segment, I think a couple of weeks down the road,
mm-hmm,
Sean.
Mm-hmm. But Part A for hospital services, Part B for physician and other outpatient services. What kind of maximum exposure could somebody be looking at you know, with just a traditional Medicare?
Well, again, all there's dollar limits next to each of these. For example, we talked about in Part A what those dollar limits were. In Part B, you've got the $166 annual deductible. For medical expenses, you got 20% of approved amount. For clinical lab services, you pay nothing for those services. For home health care, nothing for services, but 20% of the approved amount for durable medical equipment. And then outpatient hospital treatment, the coinsurance is based upon the outpatient payment rates. Then in blood, it's the first three pints plus 20% of the approved amount for additional pints. And then excess doctor charges, you pay all the excess costs.
Wow. Well, and so that's why Medicare supplemental plans are becoming so important. We'll be spending some time talking about these. But the thing that stood out to me as I was just jotting down notes as you were going, this number of 9,660. Would that be for the 61 to 90? So that's really if somebody is, what if somebody falls and breaks their hip, a senior, for example, I could almost see them. That's just an awful lot of money for somebody to have to come up with.
No, it really is. And again, it depends. When you're looking at chronic care versus someone who's had an initial expense in the hospital, the question here, as far as these dollars are concerned, how long is the patient going to be in the hospital? Medicare is now is clamping down on people who are readmitted, and they're penalizing hospitals for that kind of readmissions in their cash flow that they get directly from Medicare.
Yeah, and you bring up a terrific point. Hospital readmissions, big pain point for hospitals in the boardroom as they're trying to figure out how to control them. And you might have seen the implementation, and I know so a lot of folks that I know that are on Medicare have been admitted to a hospital and then perhaps administered a telemedicine type of program to help keep them out of the hospital as well. And this is just one example of some of the things that seniors are going to see as these things change and these incentives change for them.
Yeah, your point is well taken, Sean. Again, HHS is looking very closely at readmissions within a 30-day period of time. That's where hospitals are going to get dinged with the amount of money that they receive from HHS.
Exactly.
So that's a key point.
Anything else on Part B that you can think of?
Those are the cogent points in terms of what they're responsible for, and obviously that leads us into the reason why you make a decision for a MedSup or a MediGap plan.
Sure, which is enrollment periods.
Let's talk about the enrollment period. That's very, very important. When you turn 65 or otherwise become eligible for Medicare, you have your initial enrollment period. That begins 3 months before and ends 3 months after the month of your 65th birthday. It's a seven-month window. So if you have employer or plan-sponsored coverage when you first become eligible, you won't need to enroll until you retire, otherwise lose that coverage. So the initial enrollment period, what we call the annual enrollment period, is October 15th to December 7th. And that's what we're in right now. And so the special election period may qualify for if they retire and they lose their employer coverage, they move out of the planned service area, they receive assistance from the state, or they've been diagnosed with certain qualifying disabilities or chronic health conditions. And this is special needs plans that have other additional eligibility requirements. And then the last enrollment segment here is what we call the Medicare Advantage disenrollment period. And that's between January 1st and February 14th. You may disenroll from a Medicare Advantage plan and return to original Medicare. That's the only time that you can do that.
Does that happen a lot?
Yes, it does, and particularly this year. And it's something I was going to discuss later, but I think it's the direct answer to your question. Nearly 5 million seniors were non-renewed in 2016 from their Medicare Advantage plans.
So they could actually, the Advantage plan provider, which would be an insurance company, would they could cancel the policy for seniors?
Yeah.
And they are doing that?
They are doing that. Let me just cover that area just quickly before we take our next break. Mm-hmm. In Medicare Advantage, it provides a lower premium. It provides in-network coverage only. It's not guarantee issued. It could be underwritten. Doctors may leave those plans. The hospitals may leave, the plan. A carrier may pull out, which is what's happened this year. And seniors may lose their coverage. And they receive a certificate, not a policy. Mm. And their maximum out-of-pocket exposure, Sean, could be $6,700. That's for coinsurance, deductible, and other out-of-pocket expenses. So as I mentioned, we started this. Nearly 5 million seniors were non-renewed this year.
Wow. That's incredible. That's something, and why the shows like these are so important